Good evening, and welcome to our continuing series, Explorations in Savagery. We are still in Book 2, Canto 7, The Descent into Night, but I think we will conclude this evening. And we are always with our dear Alok Bhai as well. Namaste. We're on page 216.
Yes.
At the break.
So just a little background. This is a side of ancient mystic knowledge known in occult traditions. The Vedas, the pre-Vedic, the post-Vedic. But somehow this is a knowledge which has remained in the background. So now when we speak about spirituality, we straight away speak about the high experiences, etc. But this knowledge is a complementary knowledge which needs to be there with a seeker of truth. Otherwise, it's quite possible that he may be waylaid on the road or be misguided or turned towards other things. That's why this knowledge is so useful. I know of people who skip these two cantos, this one and the next one. And they have strange reasons. One of them told me that, you know, the person is very scared. So if you are scared of the canto in real life when you face these things, you know, none can reach heaven who has not passed through hell. At some point you have to face it. Because they are not outsiders, these are all within us. The bright heavens are within us, the supreme is within us. But also the dark powers are active within us and we need to know them. We need to acknowledge them for what they are. Plug the knowledge, if any, which they hold within themselves. And finally, we need to, you know, outsmart them, if you like.
How is the tantric disciplines of Kapalashastri, Mount of Bondage, others equate with this?
I don't know about that part, but definitely in Tantra it is there. There is the bright white Tantra and the dark Tantra. So they were aware of these forces. And in the ancient tradition, I can tell you that it was mandatory to know about these powers because there is something there which the aspirant had to acquire before he could become a final claimant to immortality. At least that's the hint given in one of the Puranic tales where Kach, who is a child of the guru of the gods, he goes to the demon Guru, the guru of the demons, Shukracharya. It's a very interesting story. Child of the guru of the gods goes to the guru of the demons because he has the Sanjeevani mantra. He has the mantra which can revive the, bring the dead back to life. It's a very fascinating tale because, you know, he befriends his daughter and then, you know, he observes how he brings the dead back to life. But this particular mantra, the guru would not give him. So finally, he really goes on a kind of a suicidal mission. So what he does is, he somehow lets the demons know that he is after this mantra. And the guru will not listen. So one day the demons kill him. Because every time they kill him, he is revived. So one day they kill him and pulverize him, burn it. And that ash they mix with Shukracharya's food. And then he eats it up. So they are very happy that now it's, you know, he is gone for good. It's a very symbolic story. But this was all part of the strategy of Kach. So when he goes inside, after a while, Devyani, whom he, you know, who was in love with him, she realizes he has gone and she understands that the demons have done them trick. So she pleads with the father that, you know, you have to bring him out. So father says, if I bring him out, then, you know, I will die because he has to come out of my stomach, womb. So she says, okay, there is a way out. You know, as he comes out, or you have to teach him the mantra, you teach me the mantra and I'll teach him the mantra and we will revive you. So all right. So he comes out, Shukracharya dies, but then he becomes a privy to the mantra, learns the mantra and he does it and Shukracharya is revived. So this is how he learns the art of Sanjeevani from the forces of darkness, goes back and gives it to the gods. So it's very interesting, even in mother's, I wouldn't use the word guru, but somebody who taught her occultism, which is not spirituality, but a side of creation, was the god of death, an incarnation of the being of death, not the god of death.
Very deep.
Yes,
very
and deep mother teach. Said not to call him a god. So, you know,
yes.
People have made him a god in their consciousness. So, the being of death. And it is when she was with him, practicing the highest kind of occultism, that she discovered the mantra of life.
Yes.
And he wanted it from her.
And she wouldn't give
him. She wouldn't give him. So he got very angry and he cut the cord. So there is a knowledge which is there in this side. And while we should not dabble into this, but at some point it comes. These forces attack. And we need to be aware how to recognize them at their very first go. And what is it that they are concealing, which will come later on, much later, toward the end of the next canto. But right now, how to recognize? So Shobindu gives us very interesting description. He has given us the various kinds of deceptions they may use. But now he gives us psychological states of consciousness. So descent of night, we imagine we have come out of the body and going into some dark realms. But we can recognize their actions simply by observing the inner psychological state. And that's where I find the tremendous utility of knowing this. A lone discoverer in these menacing realms, guarded like termite cities from the sun. So these realms, they are hiding in the hole. That's how the Vedas speak of these four enemies of truth. One of them hides in a hole, literally. So, inside the hole, the light cannot come. You can feel the warmth. So guarded like termite cities from the sun. So they are all covered all around with darkness. Oppressed mid crowd and tramp and noise and flare, passing from dusk to deeper dangerous dusk, he wrestled with powers that snatched from mind its light and smote from him their clinging influences. These are two very interesting lines. What they do, they can't straight away attack the soul. So they go step by step. Somebody once told me, what happens is that it's not like suddenly from light one falls into darkness. There are zones of gray. So one of the things they will do is they will pluck away reason and common sense. Something which is so obvious you won't be able to see. And then they will step by step lead us toward that point. Another thing, clinging influence. It's so difficult to hold light within. I'm talking of by and large, not, with everybody, but so difficult to hold the light, it slips away. But these forces will cling. They will not easily leave you. It's like, yes, we are the ultimate reality. And during this phase, a sadhak may well think, or even, of course, ordinarily human beings live under their influence, that I am useless, I am bad, I am worthless. And they will cling tenaciously to their victim. Soon he immersed in a dim, wall-less space, for now the people tracks were left behind. Look at it, dim, but wall-less. You see, now we will be shown how these forces and their states can mimic the higher states. In the higher state, there are no walls. Here also, you are entering into a dark inane, where you don't see in, because the mind creates those divisions and it's a passage, because mind likes to order things. But before that, you are entering into the inconscient, which is not organized at all. So there are no walls there, a wall-less space.
On the other end, every time I met mother, the room had no walls.
Yes, yes. That's the higher state where there is. He walked between wide banks of failing eve. Look at the beauty of this line. Failing eve. Around him grew a gaunt spiritual blank, a threatening waste, a sinister loneliness. So look at it now, spiritual blank. This state should not be confused with the true spiritual stillness, which is power. This is a state where one is unable to think. It's not an absence of thought in the higher sense, but one is unable to think, like a blank. There is no spiritual light there. That is the sign. There is a blank, but without a spiritual light. A threatening waste, a sinister loneliness. There is a higher kind of loneliness which the seeker of truth prefers. It is even one of the signs that one is ready for the divine, when one can remain lonely. Aloneness, it doesn't threaten you. But there is another state when one feels lonely, suffers from loneliness. It's like an acute something. And this loneliness can go to an extent where even if everybody is around, you feel I am alone, I am lonely, nobody cares for me, nobody understands me, nobody loves me. It's not true. Nobody is alone. If you see from day to night, from that son who, I must say, you know, what a patience and perseverance, still comes every day to wake us up. Most parents will give up after some time, you know, but he doesn't. He comes every day. To the wind that refreshes up, to the birds that chirp, to the plants that, you know, bloom, to everybody who wishes us good morning on the road, but still the feeling I am lonely. So, you know, this loneliness is described as sinister loneliness. It makes you feel that you are cut off from everything. That left mind bare to an unseen assault, an empty page on which all that willed could write. So again we will see a shadow of the higher state. Mother speaks in one of the prayer, my mind has become like an empty slate. But that's where only that she says, only the divine can write on it. But there is another kind of blankness where you are at the mercy of all kinds of forces. Any force pulls us and we just go in that direction. Because now the reason's control is lost. The spiritual will is nowhere to be seen or has not been developed. So the mind just drifts in whatever direction it is carried. A traveling dot. Oh, stark, monstrous messages without control. They start assailing the seeker or, you know, the person who is caught under the grip. And they keep on pushing one in a certain direction, as we know. Eventually towards suicide. This is how these forces attack. A traveling dot on downward roads of dusk, mid barren fields and barns and straggling huts, and a few crooked and phantasmal trees, he faced a sense of death and conscious void. The darkness looks like there is somebody out there, menacing, threatening. I just remember one, this is a very real experience of inner life. But let me talk about another experience which is more tangible. In Masai Mara, the jungle safari. So we were all huddled inside a little bus, minivan. So, but you know, I wanted to feel the jungle. It's so vast and it's lovely. You know, you feel, you can see a lot more than what you would see in a thick jungle. It's not like Amazon. It's plains with bushes here and there, but lions, everything would be so nearby. So at one place when the bus stopped, I thought that being the guest of honor, I can just get down from the bus and do my wish. So I got down and I still remember I was just trying to feel the energy of the forest. But there was something very menacing about the place. Nothing, the bus is there and I have just stepped out. And I felt that as if everything in the jungle was suddenly eyeing. I don't feel normally suspicious at all. But here was something as if the whole consciousness, because in the jungle it's a place where fear, suspicion, rage, this is the state of consciousness. And then soon enough the driver told me, sir, you are not allowed to do this. I said, yeah, I know. I guess I should get in. But this is to any degree, this darkness. It's a conscious void in that sense. It's not just empty. Yeah. But it is as if some presence is there. A dark and sinister presence is there. This is the impression that Ashupati has. But still a hostile life unseen was there. Nobody is there, but still there is something dark and hostile which is there. That's the feeling. Whose death-like poise, resisting light and truth, made living a bleak gap in nullity. So those who go through depression, they are caught up in this state. And the dark, depressive states are of this kind. From the spiritual point of view, they are an attack from these occult realms. And people don't understand it. Sometimes it's because the reason and the will, they are weak enough. So what they do is they slay the reason or at least cover it. Then they will cover the will. Then the last is faith. If they cover the faith also, then you are in a real despair. Then you have to bring in the power of hope. Then they will cover hope also. This is how they act. This is what I have seen in my clinical practice. They start with reason. Then next step is will. So you feel helpless. You feel I can't do anything. Then the next is faith. So they start doubting all the beautiful things that they have experienced in life. All the love and care of everyone. Then they will take away hope that there is no hope. And that's when they push you to the brink. So, you know, that's why the importance of knowing these subtle truths is. He heard the grisly voices that deny. Assailed by thoughts that swarmed like spectral hordes. A prey to the staring phantoms of the gloom and terror approaching with its lethal mouth. So during this phase when people go through it, they are assailed by these thoughts and suggestions that deny. They deny light, they deny hope, they deny truth, they deny God, they deny divinity, they deny beauty, they deny sweetness, they deny everything that can, you know, be a source of beauty in this world. And they come, this is their source from where they come. And Ashwapati is purposely going into these realms to discover their secret and to annul their powers. Because otherwise, how could Shurbindo, guide? And I always feel that to be a perfect guide, you have to experience this. It's not enough to experience these great high truths. And that's why Shurbindo could rescue people sometime with this small little letter. People would threaten to commit suicide, and some of his letters immediately inspire you with hope and faith. You know, that one of them I remember is where he says that the faith required of a sadhak is threefold. Faith in the guru or the master who is leading you. Yes. Faith in yourself and your spiritual destiny. And then he ends up by saying something very beautiful. To all suggestions of despair and darkness, you must say, I am a child of the Divine Mother, I cannot fail. And he reminds us again and again that it's not me who has come to the yoga just by my own efforts. It is the Divine who has called me to the yoga. What a great assurance he gives. Yes. He says that I have called you. Don't worry, you will go through these phases. Everybody goes through. Shobindu went through this phase. At one place he writes to his sadhak, for 6 months I went through this phase. So, you know, this is something which comes as a part of yoga. But right now we are being carried in Sri Aurobindo's lap into these realms. So it is very nice. You know, he is there. So we can laugh at it. Driven by a strange will down, ever down, the sky above, a communique of doom. He strove to shield his spirit from despair, but felt the horror of the growing night and the abyss rising to claim his soul. So fear and despair, at one place Mother again says, pessimism is the tail of the devil. You allow it, entertain it, feed it with nice food, and the whole thing will come. Tell him to shut up and get lost. All pessimism. And she says that, you know, who are the people who are prone towards pessimism? That also she says. Strangely, people who are very, you know, rigidly virtuous. She even goes on to say that, you know, those who are very virtuous, they take life too seriously. And they want to reduce it to a minimum number of qualities, which they confuse with perfection. And what happens at the end, they will eliminate everything from this world, except that one quality. And then, you know, it's very easy to finish that one thing, whereas truth is an integral movement. Then seized the abodes of creatures and their forms, and solitude wrapped him in its voiceless folds. There is a divine solitude which Shobindu speaks of, and solitude was his only companion left in Savitri when he said. But this is another kind of solitude. This is a dark solitude. All vanished suddenly like a thought expunged. his spirit became an empty listening gulf, void of the dead illusion of a world. Look at it. You know, this is called in Indian thought as Shamshan Vairagya. You know, when you are, something happens which you don't like, that the desired self is hurt or hit, then people go into this state of sense of illusion of the world. But this is not the sense of illusion of Vairagya which can take you to spiritual heights. It's a very temporary thing. And it's a dangerous thing because you may be caught up into it and probably be misled. Yes, yes. Shubhendu describes it in great detail in Essays on the Gita that tamasic vairagya does not have the power to turn you towards spiritual life. And I had heard a very beautiful story that once somebody goes to Saint Kabir's home, he wanted to meet Kabir. So he meets his daughter. So daughter's, where is Kabir? Oh, Papa, he has gone to the graveyard. Oh, is it? Yeah, somebody had died, so he had gone to the graveyard. You can meet him there. So as he is about to go, then he says, how will I recognize him? He said, very simple, you will see a sun glowing behind his head. It's a story, but a very interesting story. Yeah. Oh, is it? Okay, very good. So as he is going, then again she calls, she says, hold on, I must tell you one more thing. Just don't immediately rush the moment you see the sun. You wait for some time. He says, okay. So when he goes there, he sees everybody is having a sun behind. Now what to do? Then he remembers that don't rush, wait. So he waits. He sees that everybody's sun begins to drop. The only person who carries it right into the living place is Kabir. So that Vairagya has a power, you know, which looks at the world and understands what its real worth it. But this kind of a Vairagya is a dark Vairagya because born out of frustration, out of tamas. It's better to be a little more rajasic when you are in that state. Somebody came to Swami Vivekananda and says, I want to renounce the world. He said, what do you have worth renouncing? Go and earn 1 lakh rupees, then you talk about renunciation. So this Vairagya which comes from disappointment is not, does not have power. But that's what is being described, the illusion. The world appears like an illusion. Nothing was left, not even an evil face. He was alone with the grey python knight. This is the Asura described in the Vedic lore. The last battle with this python who surrounds the whole city and covers it with water is the last fight between Indra and Vritra, the last battle. So he's described as a python who surrounds the city and completely. A dense and nameless nothing, conscious, mute. Again you see, nothingness above and nothing. But what is heavy, dense? It's not something which abhorses you. It's not something which is so light. That divine nothingness is a state which is very powerful. At the same time, you are freed from all things. But this is something dense, heavy. Which seemed alive, but without body or mind. Lusted all beings to annihilate. That it might be forever nude and soul. It wants to destroy everything. It's the dark womb, nihil. And Savitri will much later experience this in inner yoga. As in a shapeless beast's intangible jaw, gripped, strangled by that lusting, viscous blot, attracted to some black and giant mouth and swallowing throat and a huge belly of doom, his being from its own vision disappeared, drawn towards depths that hungered for its fall. So, you know, many of these stories in our Puranas, like one of the asuras which Sri Krishna has to meet is Aghasur. He is a giant python. What does he do? Just keeps the mouth open, that's all. And all of them walk into that python. And then the python closes the mouth. That's it. All this darkness. Of course, Krishna is light, so he, you know, tears open. But this is the way they work. One falls into that trap and then they swallow the being. A darkness drawn towards depths that hungered for its fall, a formless void oppressed his struggling brain. A darkness, grim and cold, benumbed his flesh. A whispered grace suggestion chilled his heart. This is a very simple test. You know, you can recognize its action when the heart begins to become cold. It's a very deadly sign. And mother cautions people that, you know, she speaks about if the Chinese, they came.
Yes.
She says, my God, it will be earth becoming ice cold. Cold like the bone, because if this is not there, if the heart's warmth is missing, that's what they say. So it's a very simple sign. And, you know, by the way, in psychiatry, we use this as one of the signs. Ice cold wall, you know, it's, you can recognize that a being is under the grip of something very dark. Of course, psychiatry doesn't use the word dark and grip of things, but it's one of the signs. You feel there is a glass wall. You just can't get across. The heart is blocked completely. There's a coldness here. Cold. This is a chill. That's how it is. Hailed by a serpent force from its warm home and dragged to extinction in bleak vacancy, life clung to its seat with cords of gasping breath. Lapped was his body by a tenebrous tongue. So this is the anaconda original. The others are all movies. This is the original anaconda in spiritual life. Drags you like this. We must not lose sense of humor even in the worst kind of darkness. It is one thing that these fellows don't like. If they see you can face life with a humor, they run away ultimately. They say he's not worth, he cannot be, because they hate it. They hate life, they hate hope. They hate joy. They want to finish it.
Mother says even a smile.
Even a smile. It's simple one test. If you want to know a person is healthy or not, don't do treadmill, this, that, 100 things. See if the person smiles. If the person smiles, then you can write all okay. Pocket your 10,000. But doctors have to learn that, no? After all the tests, they will sit with grim faces and the poor patient is having heartbeat. What's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? And if he says everything is okay, then patient is not happy, you know, strangely. Are you sure? Because he has spent money. You must find something wrong. So if he says everything is okay, that is also not okay. So he must say something. Then he will point out, you know, this enzyme is a little raised. What do you think about it? What do you think? Smile. Smile is such a simple thing and we, you know, lose it. So people ask sometimes, what have you got in the ashram? So I say, one thing for sure, got back the smile, which one loses, you know. Existence smothered, travailed to survive. Hope strangled, perished in his empty soul. Belief and memory abolished, died, and all that helps the spirit in its course. Belief and memory. Not even faith. Even when faith goes, belief that yes, there is a power. And memory. Memory of beautiful things. In life, we all have faced beautiful things. Grace of God. And we forget it. During that moment, it looks like God is cruel. And mother says, you should remember the beautiful moments when you go through these states. That yes. But they attack the memory also. There crawled through every tense and aching nerve, leaving behind its poignant, quaking trail, a nameless and unutterable fear. This is the last and the darkest attack, fear. And mother at one place says very interestingly, the greatest impurity is fear. Anything. And you see how Sri Krishna, when he starts liberating Arjuna, he starts with, what is it you are not afraid of? You are afraid of this, you are afraid of that, you are afraid of sin, you are afraid of this, doing this. What is it that you are not afraid of? First, he shakes away the fear. It's the darkest kind of impurity.
And mother says the most dangerous.
Most dangerous. In fact, she has gone on to tell a sadhak, if you are so afraid, you cannot do yoga. Yeah. It's this fear. Fear must go. What is it? But this is there. they attack with an unutterable fear. And then the nerves ache. As a sea nears a victim bound and still, look at, you know, Poseidon and the Perseus, the deliverer, that scene. Symbol is there. As a sea nears a victim bound and still, the approach alarmed his mind forever dumb of an implacable eternity of pain inhuman and intolerable. This is probably the, you know, when we read about Prometheus, he's bound and he's forever suffering, you know, thrown into the abyss. So sometimes this is the state in which we are caught. It is not eternal, but it seems eternal. That repeatedly Mother and Shobindu remind, there is nothing like an eternal darkness or eternal hell. But it seems like an eternity. Again, we see that this is a shadow of truth. And it's an inhuman pain. See, it's not like a physical pain. It's very difficult for those who suffer psychologically to say that I've got pain. People mock because they can't see tangible something. This he must bear. So if we really want to move up the path, endurance, ability to bear things in life, all kinds of things, this is a basic requirement. This he must bear. His hope of heaven is estranged. He must ever exist without extinction's peace. You are denied even to escape from that state. Look at this darkness. In a slow, suffering time and tortured space, an anguished nothingness, his endless state. Lifeless vacancy was now his breast, and in the place where once was luminous thought, only remained like a pale, motionless ghost, an incapacity for faith and hopes. As I said, this is the last thing which is attacked. Incapacity for faith and hope, then this heart becomes numb, chill, love seems to die. Nothing is dead, but they are all covered. You just can't feel them inside.
But he's experiencing this every moment.
Every moment. He has to go through this. And the dread conviction of a vanquished soul, immortal still, but with its Godhead lost. Okay, yes, there is soul. But what is it? It becomes a captive. Self lost and God in touch of happier worlds. You see, there are people who have actually ended up, you know, committing suicide, having had the bliss of meeting the divine, having received so much. I mean, it's a fact. There are instances. They can be so badly caught up in these states. Because during that time, you just close yourself. But he endured, stilled the vain terror, bore the smothering coils of agony and affright. This is the hallmark. When this kind of test comes, sadhak goes through this test of fire, endures it. But the other one succumbs. This is a passage through which, as he has told us, everybody passes some time or the other. But some break down, others pass through. Some have to return back. Once again, be equipped and face it, because there is no other way. Then peace returned and the soul's sovereign gaze. This is the inner epic of the human soul. To the blank horror, a calm light replied. Immutable, undying and unborn. Mighty and mute, the Godhead in him woke and faced the pain and danger of the world. So often people ask, they say, what do you do in the ashram? Huh? You've gone there for getting peace, so you don't know what to say. You have to tell them, peace, yes, but it is not just the peace of the dead man. It is the peace of Shiva, for which you have to go through the whole tandav and the entire mystery of creation with all its highs and lows, so that this peace can become true, authentic, lasting and infinite. In marvelous lines, of course, reminds you of Shobindu. He mastered the tides of nature with a look. He met with his bare spirit naked hell. this is the hell of darkness, of depression, of despair, of inconscient. I remember a small story with which we learned. You know, Dada used to be very, Pranabdha, used to be very prone to these fits of depression. He recounts it himself. So he would go through these days. Sometimes he would be playing the game and he would be taken up with this. He'll throw away the racket and just walk. And mother would leave the game and she would go and catch hold of him. And he would sometimes walk in that state for miles and miles. Of course, he says, much later I understood that this was my desired self, which I was not acknowledging. And this is how the divine was removing it. But that time, obviously. So when he was so prone to these attacks, that one day mother caught him, took him all the way to Shobindu. You can imagine, you know, like veritable Mahakali, dragging Dada and putting him in front of Shobindu. She said, Lord, here he is. You know, all she told his state. And then he says, Sri Aurobindo just looked at him and said, And I look, mastered nature. When I read this story, it think, Sri Aurobindo majestically, he didn't say anything. He didn't say, you know, you should not feel like this. You are here, such a nice place. Do some breathing techniques or, you know, I'll give you a mantra. Nothing. He just looked at him and did, And he says, after that, my depression began to leave me.
And he just looked at Kiki when
Kiki, when that the scorpion reviving from the dead.
The cat.
Yes.
Just looked at it.
Reviving from the dead.
And it
what
came back.
What compassion, what power. I just can't imagine. Shobindu looks, I was just thinking what would be modern, you know, if he went to a psychiatrist, they'll prescribe some medicine and give a diagnosis. If he went to a so-called mystic, he'll say, no, you do my breathing technique, you'll be fine. Practice this, that. Or, you know, somebody else will blame it on his past karmas. 100 things. Shobindu does nothing, just looks at him and says, that's enough to drive away. Amazing. So with these last two lines, we'll stop. He mastered the tides of nature with a look. He met with his bare spirit, naked hell. A more positive story, just since we are talking about it, you know, when the tornado had come and storms used to come. And the mother goes all the way to his room to close the windows because, you know, she thought all the water must be flooding
rain
his room.
Must be
And the papers may be flying. So she goes to Shobindu's room. She sees the same tremendous peace. Windows are open. Shobindu is sitting on the desk and writing. Not a drop of water is entering inside. What a power, just his presence is enough to keep these forces. You may do whatever you want to do. Even the fakir who tried to throw stones, he said, I can't throw anything within 25 meters or yards or whatever of his this thing. It's just not possible. I need a medium to go there. And then when he's dying on the deathbed because the whole karma fell back upon him, his wife goes running to Sri Aurobindo to seek his compassion. That he is dying because he tried this black magic on you. Shobindu says, death for a few stones. And he recovers. What a power. So we'll stop here. And we'll start the new canto, canto 8, next Monday. The world of falsehood, the mother of evil, and the sons of darkness.